More than 20 years ago, the World Bank described Gaza's water problems as an emergency state of affairs. And in the time that has passed, the outlook has only grown more dire, with the UN warning Gaza's supply of fresh water will run dry sometime next year. China's polluted rivers and lakes are potentially a bigger health hazard than its grey, smoke-filled skies. One Beijing-based environmental group says, according to data from the 12,000 sites where surface water is tested, 35% have water of good quality. Another 32% are suitable for water supply. 20% can be used for industrial or agricultural purposes, but not for human consumption. And 13% are useless. In other words, at least a third of China's waterways are undrinkable. Similar problems too for India, which has followed the China model for rapid economic growth, with an online magazine produced by Yale reporting. According to India's Central Pollution Control Board, 63% of urban sewage flowing into rivers, some 62 billion litres a day, is untreated. In addition, riverbanks, wetlands and floodplains have been claimed over time by infrastructure, slums, offices and housing developments, all of which has narrowed natural river channels and distorted flow, greatly reducing the ability of India's rivers to buffer flooding. It has also taken a toll on biodiversity. World Vision says around the world, 1 in 10 do not have access to safe, clean drinking water. And to be sure, there seems no end to these depressing and disturbing facts, which read like an indictment on our collective neglect and abuse of a crucial and scarce resource. And think about this one just for a moment. Again, the people at World Vision say every day more than 800 children under the age of 5 die from diarrhea attributed to unsafe water. Ultimately, it's a story of the haves versus the have-not. The ones without the clean water are the ones who suffer, while those who have it tend to think in terms of an almost endless resource. And that's where Nadia Sosky comes in. She joins us now from Los Angeles. Okay, so now, I guess, you know, for many people, you have that unmistakable last name. You're the great-great-granddaughter of Daniel Swarovski, founder of the famous company, you know, for crystals and jewelry. But beyond your role in the family business, you've also dedicated a big part of your life to raising awareness to the scarcity of water and ways to preserve it. So why take on that issue? Is there a specific event or a personal reason for all of this?
Absolutely. It is a family reason, really. The company has been founded because of the water source that comes out of the mountain just above the factory. My great-great-grandfather in 1895 actually used the water power to power his machines. So water is a huge element in our manufacturing and production. However, we recycle the water. We take care of our environment. We also recycle the fumes that come out of the factory. But we really initially started to work with the local Austrian National Park on the issues there, evolving water. And this was how the first water school was born 20 years ago, which we have subsequently rolled out into various different countries such as India, China, Africa, South America, North America. And we're addressing the various different issues of water, whether it's scarcity, whether it's pollution, sanitation. And it's really important for us to raise the awareness and to educate young people about the various issues, but also we are teaching them how to handle and counteract the various different issues.
I just wonder, as a business person, because you have a very senior position within the company. So, mm-hmm. what we're seeing in India and China in particular, and other countries as well, is, you know, we'll pollute first and then we'll clean up after we're rich. You know, they'll do whatever they got to do to get the economy going, and then they'll take care of it later on. I mean, essentially what the United States did about 100 years ago. That doesn't seem to be working. They're spending billions of dollars to try and improve these waterways and other ecosystems, and it's just not having the impact they hoped it would.
That's right. And what we're really trying to do is we're trying to raise the awareness within the young generation of what's actually really going on. And what we're seeing in this water school film is that the increased awareness of the young person towards the topic is just moving them so much to actually trying to come up with solutions and certainly try to counteract what's happening. We're seeing tremendous amount of passion within the Chinese girls. We're seeing a huge commitment dedication within India. But what's been so fascinating about this documentary is as we're teaching the children about the environment, we also see a tremendous self-awareness increasing within themselves, and their self-confidence grows. So I think by teaching them about these issues, we're really also making them realize that they, as individuals, can truly have a big impact, an impact that is absolutely detached from any materialism. So as you mentioned earlier, the have and have nots, yes, there is a huge difference there in the way water is treated worldwide, but the message here is you do not have to have a solid financial base in order to have a positive impact in dealing with the issues.
Last year, Water School was the subject of a Netflix documentary which you produced, and here's a clip. Have a look.
Remember what this represented?
Yes.
Water. All the water in the world, 0.01%, is something that we can use. That one drop is what we need to take care of.
Yeah, I thought that was the moment. That, you know, this whole issue of water scarcity is really put into context, and a context Absolutely. Which is rarely seen. Is that, you know, for these kids, is that like the aha moment?
It is such an aha moment, and the clip that we just see here is actually done from the Mississippi River, and it's been really amazing to actually realize that a lot of these children haven't even touched the Mississippi River. It's just 15 miles away. So again, we are really giving them the facts and figures, but we're putting everything into their local context as well. And it's been amazing to see the reception of the young children and the willingness to make a positive change.
From Mississippi to Los Angeles, where you have spent most of Thursday with, 500 students at Notre Dame Girls Academy. Yeah, this is a fairly privileged group of kids, upper middle class. They come from a certain socioeconomic group. But have you noticed, within that group, when you go around and talking to those sort of kids, a real change in their tone and the questions which they're asking from when this all began?
Absolutely. And I have to say, for me personally, it was so inspirational and uplifting to see their reaction towards the film. We have had the chance to speak to 25 of the girls after the screening, and they all have expressed tremendous appreciation of living where they're living, absolute gratitude. They are now looking forward to going to university, and a lot of them did mention that they really look forward to their extended knowledge and education to then put themselves in a position, in a leadership position, to yet further that positive change. So I have to say, it's been wonderful to see those girls also identify with the children from the Water School film, from different environments. It's wonderful to see that they're all identifying with each other on a human basis.
Well, Nadja, there's a lot of good, there's a lot of positive things coming out of this on many, many levels.
Yes.
So well done. Thank you. And great to speak with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.